we'll launch in here to our first plenary session. If we haven't had a chance to meet yet, my name is Annie Rose. I am blessed to serve the EPC as the National Director of Ministerial Support and Development. And it's my privilege this morning to kick off our very first plenary session of this 44th General Assembly and Gospel Priority Summit. This is the Effective Biblical Leadership plenary session on the topic of closing the generation gap in leadership. So thank you for being with us this morning. And now I would like to introduce the moderator of our 39th General Assembly, Case Thorpe, as he introduces our speaker.
Good morning, good morning. Come on, everybody. Come on in and have a seat. We're getting started. So I want to know, does FedEx know that we ripped off their logo? See it? I was sitting there and I went, that's cool. Very cool. Well, yes, I'm a teaching elder at First Presbyterian Orlando, and glad and thrilled and honored to introduce my good buddy, Jim Davis. If you would, let's say a word of prayer. Father, we do ask that you would be in Jim's words, as we know you are in his heart and in his work, and may we be blessed by it. In Christ's name, amen. So the Reverend Jim Davis is the teaching pastor at Orlando Grace Church, OGC, part of the Acts 29 network. Now, I'm sorry to say that he's a Baptist. You know, he's a Baptist, but the good news is he's a Reformed Baptist. And as I like to call him, my insufferable credo Baptist friend. We argue about such things all the time. This is in spite, though, of being a son of First Presbyterian Church of Orlando, right? So, like, he grew up at the church, his parents are right here, but we lost him. We lost him. But he is doing great things. Jim has a Master of Divinity from Reformed Theological Seminary. He's a member of the Gospel Coalition Council, host of the As in Heaven podcast. He's also my official podcast coach, as I try to make mine as cool and as good as his. He and his wife, Angela, who also has a counseling degree from Reformed Theological Seminary, they are frequent speakers at the Family Life's Weekend to Remember Marriage Retreats, and they have four beautiful children, beautiful children. He's with us today because he is the co-author of a very successful book called The Great Dechurching, which I think is going to be up on the screen there. And friends, this book has hit it big. It's been featured in the New York Times, by NPR, The Ben Shapiro Show. All sorts of national media outlets have paid attention, and for good reason. The research is significant, and the application is very effective. So here at this Gospel Priority Summit, we especially need to hear deeply what he has to share about those we've lost from the church here on earth, and those that we can hopefully reclaim. So would you please welcome the Reverend Jim Davis.
Well, I really appreciate being here today, and I cannot address a group of Presbyterians without telling my favorite Presbyterian story. Some of you may know or know of one of my closest friends, Mike Aitchison. He planted a multi-ethnic PCA church near downtown Orlando. And there was a Sunday that I wasn't preaching a couple years ago, and we were in town not doing anything. So I told the kids and my wife, why don't we go to the Aitchison's church? I would love to go and see what it's like over there. And we went, and it was amazing. He was actually dressed in African garb on that Sunday. They had the organ. They bring just so much of the riches of the historic Black American church into what they do. They sang songs we've never even heard before. And they, I mean, in the liturgy, even outside of the singing, Mike Aitchison is singing to the congregation, and the congregation singing back to him. It really was something to see. It was amazing. And so we got in the car afterwards, and I asked my kids, well, what'd y'all think about that? And my second oldest son said, well, that was interesting. And then my oldest turned back and said, Collins, that's because they're Presbyterian. And I love that that is what my kids think of now when they hear Presbyterian. And so it is true. I think on my mom's side, who's sitting right there, I am fifth generation Presbyterian on that side, and I went rogue. I went prodigal theologically. I am a Baptist, but my mom also affectionately calls me a Baptarian because I am as close, I think, as you can get to being Presbyterian without baptizing babies. So that is a title I will gladly wear. And, you know, I believe deeply, no matter how efficient or inefficient we are with our water use, that we are brothers and sisters in Christ today, every day, here especially, as we gather. And not only brothers and sisters, we are co-laborers in the Great Commission that Jesus has given us. And we have, I would argue, the privilege of ministering in this season that we call the Great Dechurching. So when I talk about the Great Churching, I do apologize, we had some technical difficulties, so instead of hitting the button, I'm gonna say next, next. When we talk about the Great Dechurching, what are we talking about? We're talking about 40 million adult Americans who have left the church largely over the past 25 to 30 years. So to put this in perspective in terms of numbers, we're talking about more people leaving the church today than came to Christ or came to the church through the First Great Awakening, the Second Great Awakening, and all the Billy Graham Crusades combined, making it the largest and fastest religious shift in the history of our country. By percentage, we're talking about the last greatest shift that we had was the 25 years post-Civil War, that with people returning to church, immigrating, going to church for the first time. Our transition, our shift that we're experiencing today is 25% greater than that, just going the opposite direction. So you can just kind of follow along with me as best you can on the slides. How did we get here? This project, I am not a sociologist, I'm not a social scientist, I'm not a data analyst, this is not who I am. The people that know me, it's kind of laughable that I've fallen into this space with the assistance of some very qualified people. But this started as an Orlando-based cultural exegetical project. So I grew up in Orlando, Florida, and how many of you have lived or live in Orlando, Florida? I feel like I've met a number of you. Okay, so then you may know that in the 90s and early 2000s, so kind of my coming of age in late 80s, Orlando felt like a type of Christian Mecca. Because institutionally, you know, on the church side at least, you had First Presbyterian Church, Cases Church, second largest mainline church in the United States. The Southern Baptist, the First Baptist Church there was pastored by Jim Henry, who was the president of the Southern Baptist Convention. You had Joel Hunter, who was pioneering things in the non-denominational tech space. He was also actually advising presidents too. You had R.C. Sproul come down, plant two churches. You even had Benny Hinn down in Orlando doing his thing over on the west side of town. And then institutionally, you had RTS move there, Campus Crusade moved there. You had Wycliffe, Pioneer, Ligonier, all these different organizations headquartered in Orlando, and it felt like everything was going amazing. Then you fast forward to 2018 when I moved back to Orlando to pastor Orlando Grace Church, and Orlando now has the same percentage of evangelicals as New York City and Seattle. What was interesting to us wasn't only the how did you get here, but it was also very interesting to us, why does culturally do we feel so different than New York City and Seattle? And the answer is, it hit us pretty quickly. The vast majority of the people that we talk to who don't go to church used to go to church. The vast majority of the people still carry with them some biblical values and in many cases seem to be Christians themselves. So we started asking the question, could we be in the largest and fastest religious shift in the history of our country? We knew this wasn't just an Orlando phenomenon, although I do think it hit Orlando uniquely hard. The problem was there was no more data. And you see this on the next slide. The old data that we have was old. It was not actionable data. It was not pastorally actionable. Moving on, you can see we didn't have data that was post-fracturing. So there's a lot that's been written on the fracturing of the evangelical church post largely 2018. We needed post-COVID data. We needed academically credible data. The data that existed wouldn't have held muster in certain academic circles. We needed granular insights that we could do something about in the church. So for me, there was this really important moment. We knew we didn't have the data we needed, but there was this moment the Lord used to show me it isn't just about data. And I gave a 10-minute talk at a donor gathering for a global organization, and I opened for Max Licato. Me 10 minutes, and then Max Licato does his thing, and he's Max Licato. I'm nobody, and he gave a great keynote address, and then afterwards, I had this surreal moment where I had a line of people to talk to me, and I look over, and Max is getting coffee by himself, which didn't make any sense. Until I began to hear the stories of the people who were in line to talk to me, and I realized I'm talking about their kids and their grandkids and their nephews and their nieces and their neighbors. So it hit me. This is not what we're doing. It's not just about statistics. It's not just about getting butts in pews and money in coffers. We are talking about reaching not only this country we live in, but I'm talking about reaching the next generation as well. And hopefully that will become clear as we move through this. So you can go to the next slide. So de-churching, how do we describe de-churching? We hired Ryan Burge, who's a PhD sociologist. He's also a pastor. He's a Christian. We raised $100,000 to do the largest nationwide quantitative, academically peer-reviewed study on de-churching that has ever happened. And in this study, we defined de-churching as someone, as you can see, an adult American who used to attend church at least monthly and now goes less than once per year. Now, this is very important because we could have said somebody who goes once a year. You all right? How many people do you see who are only in your church on Easter or only in your church on Christmas Eve? So you can make an argument that the problem that we're trying to start a conversation about, we're not under any impression that we're going to single-handedly solve the largest and fastest religious shift in the history of a country, but the problem that we want to start getting people to talk about more and add their expertise and their gifting to this conversation really probably is larger than any of us realize. We just wanted to be conservative and reasonable and above reproach in the way we did our research. So that's how we defined it. Let me go to the next slide. So when we think about this de-churching, most of it has happened over the past 20 years. You can go to the next slide, and we can see the spike right there. That I don't know how many of you can see this. This is a graph from 1910, more or less, to today. And you see the 1990s. If I have a laser pointer, I'd point at it. But the 1990s is where it really shoots up. Now, we're going to talk about why the 1990s. Social scientists would all agree that a spike like this doesn't come out of nowhere, and they would be right. So we can talk about 1776. We can talk about theological liberalism. We can talk about immigration policies. All of those led up to this, but that's beyond the scope of what we're here to talk about this morning. What I also, on the next slide, want to look at is this relationship between the economic development of a country and its religiosity. There's a very well-known and studied relationship that says the more economically developed a country is, the less religious it is going to be. But then you see this green outlier up there, which is the United States. So we are what social scientists call stubbornly religious. They can't explain it. But the reason I have this up here is because I want to articulate that if, humanly speaking, regression to the mean is a thing, and it, humanly speaking it is, how much farther we have to go if the trajectory does not change. You go to the next slide. So, as we said, we're talking about in the 40 million, about 15% of all Americans. This 40 million number, about 15 million are people who have de-churched from evangelical churches. About 20 million are people who have de-churched from both mainline and Roman Catholic spaces. And then about 5 million have de-churched from what we would consider to be non-Orthodox Christian houses of worship. So Jehovah's Witness, Mormons, Judaism, Islam, those kinds of places. Next slide. So why the 1990s? Four things happened in the 1990s that are very important to understand. First is the fall of the Soviet Union. So I am old enough to remember a time if somebody had said, I am no longer a Christian, the next question very well could have been, well, are you a communist? Like, the younger people in our church can't believe that that was even a thing. How many of you remember, help me feel like I'm not on an island here, you remember that that was a thing because we were engaged as the Christian Americans against these godless atheists, and our government had plans of propaganda to reinforce that. It's not a coincidence that under the Eisenhower administration, we got "In God We Trust" on our money. This is when "Under God" came about on our Pledge of Allegiance. So when the Soviet Union fell, in many places around the country, especially urban places, you could for the very first time be a patriot but not a Christian. But then secondly, we have the rise of the internet. 1994, you have internet cafes popping up. 97, even though they're only in about 20% of the homes, they are in most of the schools and libraries, and you can now freely look at other worldviews without the social persecution it would have brought on you up to that point to investigate these other worldviews. You have the rise of the religious right. Many people said, you know, as syncretism began to rise between the political right and Christianity, a number of people have said, if that's what Christianity is, I'm out. And then at the end of the decade, or just a hair past 9/11, you have the mortal enemies of the United States go from the godless atheists to the religious fundamentalists. And people would say, see, that's what religion does, and if that's what religion does, I'm out. And now we would argue that the dechurching we saw in the 1990s is largely going to happen, well, we know, we wouldn't just argue, it is on the political left, the secular left, but what we would argue is most of the people leaving church at that point, they're using these four things as an excuse to show and embrace what they already knew to be true. They were not Christians. So then you fast forward to today and you ask the question, why is it that so many people are leaving church? Well, you have two very old stories, and the story you embrace probably depends on your media intake. So if your media intake is more to the left, you're going to hear that it is the church's problem, that it's racism in the church, misogyny in the church, scandal and abuse in the church, Christian nationalism. If your intake is more to the right, you're going to hear that it's the culture's problem. You're going to hear that it's the sexual revolution, secular progressivism. And what we found in our study is that both are right and both are wrong. So certainly both of those old stories, they fit because there are people who have left for those reasons. But neither of those stories explain the lion's share of dechurching that's happening. You could put both of those stories in the same bucket, and we're still only talking about a small minority of the dechurching that's happening. So do you want to know the number one reason for dechurching in the United States? I moved. It's boring. It's pedestrian. Nobody's tweeting about it. Nobody's angry about it. These are who we call the casually dechurched. People who dechurch. Oh, and by the way, this study will be, or this slide presentation will be made available to you. If it frees you up, you're happy to take pictures, take notes, whatever, but this will be made available to all the commissioners here. So 30 million people dechurched without any significant pain, without intentionally even meaning to dechurch. They dechurched because they moved, because attendance was inconvenient, because there was a family change, often becoming a single parent, however that happens. Then you have the other 10 million that we call the dechurched casualties. They did dechurch intentionally. There is a pain point. They didn't fit in. They experienced suffering. They experienced church hurt. They experienced church scandal. So on the next slide, what we want to articulate is that the dechurched are not monolithic. So when we are looking as ministers of the gospel to engage the dechurched, we would be remiss if we looked at them as one group of people. There are very different types of people who have dechurched. Now, casually and casualty, that's the highest level. But what we've realized, and I'm going to walk through this a little more, is that some people, shockingly, all they need is a nudge and they're back in church with you. That's all they require. Some are going to need to be at your dinner table before they're back in church. And some are going to need real friendship to be in your life for years or even decades, and probably going to need the Holy Spirit to do something that none of us can do. So with that in mind, I want to look at, we did a deep dive on those who have dechurched from evangelical spaces. We did this, we did three consecutive studies, and the last one really zeroed in on evangelicalism because this is an Orlando-based project, this is for our church, and we want to understand what's happening with our people. Why are we losing our people? So we ran this massive amount of data. You know, some people think that we have these four evangelical D-Church profiles, and they think that like we put our finger up in the air and came up with these. But we ran all of this through what's called a machine learning algorithm that took all this data and came up with profiles based on common answer choices. And then we studied these groups and named these groups. And I want to walk very briefly. For some of you, there's a lot of data in this next section. We're not going to cover all this data. Some of you love data and you live for data. Some of you are willing to endure data if it gives you pastorally actionable stuff to do. So I'm gonna try and meet you both in the middle, and I'll walk through it very fast. And again, this presentation is available later. So the first group, cultural Christians. This is the largest group of D-Church evangelicals. We're talking about 8 million people, largely male, largely white group. They've been out of the church about 10 years. Next slide. Next slide. What's fascinating about this group, we tested each group on what we gave them an orthodoxy score, and we're using the Nicene Creed here. So this isn't the Westminster Confession of Faith. Like, this is the Nicene Creed, basic orthodoxy. And the orthodoxy score was not good at 56%, but we then isolated for each group how many of these people would say that Jesus is the Son of God, because that's probably the best telltale as to whether we're looking at a Christian or not. 1% of these 8 million people would say that Jesus is the Son of God. They have de-churched casually. They did not do so intentionally. They largely remain, they've retained a positive view of the church, but only 1% believes that Jesus is the Son of God. So we're looking, in all, you know, as best we can tell, at non-Christians here. Next slide. So why they left? Attending was inconvenient. My friends were not attending worship. I moved to a new community. So top three, casual. Suffering changed my views of God and or the congregation. This is not abuse or neglect. This is own personal suffering, and they didn't have the categories to understand what to do with it. Number five, I wanted to be able to express my gender identity. This is the only place on this study that this shows up. LGBTQ issues are shockingly not here. They just did not present themselves in the de-churching data outside of this one particular niche of de-church evangelicals. Scandal involving the broader clergy. Okay, so we're talking probably non-Christians using that as a reason to get out of the church slowly. This isn't affecting them. Eight, I felt like the church was being too restrictive of my sexual freedom. This is interpreted as more heterosexual sexual freedom. Why they might return. This is what I want us to see. Do we see a common denominator here? New friends, lonely and want to make new friends. So supernatural phenomenon is more like the Bible floats on my table kind of thing. Begin to miss church. Number five, friends invite me, spouse wants to go, move and want to make new friends, a good community. So they're articulating why they would come back, and what they're saying is largely relational in nature, even though it seems like they're not Christians. So they're going to need the gospel, but the gospel in the context of a relationship. So what do they need? Sincere community, mental health help. I don't have time to flesh that out, but it's significant. It's in the book. Sound doctrine and spiritual formation, because we're not looking at people who understand Orthodox Christianity. Better engagement in 18 to 30 range that we're going to flesh out here in a little bit. The next group, mainstream evangelicals. This is 2.5 million people. This group looks almost identical to the first group in that it's largely white. They're more female than male, but you notice they've de-churched in the last largely 3 to 5 years. Keep going. When you get to their orthodoxy score, though, on the next slide, 98% of them would say that Jesus is the Son of God. So this group, 100% of them said they are willing to come back today. It looks like we're talking about Christians who have gotten out of the habit largely over the COVID season, and there are 2.5 million of them that said they would come back today. I'm going to come back to this group and the way that I minister to this group in a little bit, but continuing on, why they say that they left, you're going to see again, this group is casually de-churched, moved to a new community, attending was inconvenient, COVID-19, this is the only group that pops up, divorce, remarriage, or another family change. Number five, we say, I didn't fit in the congregation, I didn't experience much love in the congregation. So we have to remember that happened at the highest point of political and racial turmoil in our church. So it's not like they were harmed by it and intentionally left. They would cite it as a reason they got out, after having gotten out of the habit, they didn't go back. What they need, new friends. They would say, and again, this is them telling us, God tells me to go back in some significant way. So this is not Bible floating on the desk. This is I am convicted because I have the Holy Spirit inside of me that I need to go back. Find a church I like, begin to miss church, feel the distance from God, a good pastor, lonely and want to make new friends, and a church that takes both doctrine and ethics seriously. They want our ethics to match our doctrine because they are Christians. What do they need? Relational nudge. This group, I am batting 1,000. When I can identify this group and invite them to church, I am batting 1,000 in them actually coming. Now, how do I identify them? I'll talk about in a little bit. Doctrine and ethics seriously challenge their distance from God and better engagement in 18 to 39 range. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. Ex-evangelicals. We tried hard not to use a term that our larger culture is using, but this is the best term for this group. We couldn't get around it, so we're trying to redefine what an ex-evangelical means. Because we have this idea, when we think of an ex-evangelical, we might think of a young guy in his 20s who's highly educated, is irritated by the church, is not a Christian, and is very loud on Twitter about it. That is not what you're going to see. This is a group that is largely middle-aged women. They've been out for 20 years, continuing on. They have de-churched, they're de-churched casualties. They are done with white evangelicalism as a sociological term. They are not coming back, according to them. But 97% believe that Jesus is the Son of God. We're still talking about believers. So this is going to be the dinner table group, the people that we need to have in our home, in our lives. And for what it's worth, in my reformed complementarian circles, we've had people that I have walked with back to church, but not our church. I've walked them into gospel-believing churches who are going to feel different, who would not be considered white evangelicalism, because it's not about our little K kingdom. It is about the big K kingdom. So continuing on, why they left. You're going to see, didn't fit within the congregation. I moved to a new community. Attending was inconvenient. I didn't experience much love from the congregation. Number five, we see I disagreed with the politics of the congregation. I'm going to come back to that. Negative experiences they personally had in an evangelical church. I no longer believed what the congregation believed, and I disagreed with the politics. So this group is going to be highly allergic to political syncretization. This group is not, if there's a church that aligns with the left or the right completely, they are never going to be okay. They say they will return if God tells them to come back in some significant way. Again, looking at their, it makes sense if they have the Holy Spirit within them that they are going to be open to conviction from the Holy Spirit. Find a church I like, good pastor. First time we see never going back. Feel the distance from God. I found a church who cares about justice and compassion for vulnerable people. So this group, they not only care about avoiding political syncretism, they also want to see a church that is propping up the poor and vulnerable in their society. They want a good community, or if they just begin to miss church. What this group needs is nonpartisan church community, a church that takes doctrine and ethics seriously. They need mental health help in a significant way, and an empathetic community and clergy. Then lastly, we have this fascinating group. This group is what we call BIPOC, Black Indigenous People of Color. What I want you to hear, the main thing I want you to hear in this, is that we hid race and ethnicity from the algorithm. We did not let it see it, and it still came up with a group that was 0% white based on common answer choices. And the sociologist would say race casts a long shadow in the data. You don't even need to see race to understand that people who are not white are going to have a different, largely speaking, a different experience in what sociologists call white evangelicalism. This group has been out, as you can see, for over 20 years. If you were to take a stereotypical person in this group, imagine a black male living in Atlanta who's done very well for himself. This group is the most educated, the highest income earning group of all of these profiles. But this stereotypical African-American male stopped going to church when he established his young professional career. Now, I would say of all the areas that we've done research, this merits a lot more. You can see they resemble in some ways the cultural Christians because they're only 13% would say Jesus is the Son of God, 58% orthodoxy score is not great, 29% believe the Bible is a little word of God, not great. But it's this hodgepodge of casually and casualty. Next slide. Institutions, as you can see, do not work well for them. Now, this is something I do want to camp out on because it's true of BIPOC and ex-evangelicals. Typically, America works well for people who are on what we would call the American path. So that means growing up with two parents, after you graduate high school, going to college, then you get married, then you have kids, then you stay married. If you get off that track, America tends to not work as well for you, which is so sad that the institution of the church in America so reflects the values of the worldly country that we happen to live in, because if you go back to the first century, what was one of the main things that attracted people to the church? It's attention to the poor and the vulnerable and the disenfranchised. This is why the church was full of poor people and women who did not have socially the value that they should. They didn't have the rights. And so we're seeing both with the ex-evangelicals and the BIPOC that this is coming into play. Continuing on. They left because they moved to a new community. Faith just wasn't working, had other priorities for their time and money. Suffering changed their views. So again, hodgepodge. Number five, we see I began to doubt God's existence. Scandal involving my congregation. I didn't see the congregation doing enough good in the community, and the messages were not relevant to my life. So the relevancy of the messages, we flesh that out in the book in high schoolers' experience, what D-Church people say about their high school experience. But why they might return, you still see a lot of these relational components. New friends, move and want to make new friends, lonely and want to make new friends, child wants to go, friends invite me, a good community, spouse wants to go, feel the distance from God. So there's still these relational components, and what they need cultural and emotional intelligence, they need deep friendship, they need sound doctrine and spiritual formation, and again, this thing that we're going to come back to, better engagement in the 13 to 30 range. Now, mainline and Roman Catholic, I'm going to go really fast through this, they almost mirror each other, with one unsurprising exception. Roman Catholics are more affected by church scandal than mainline, and mainline is more affected by moving. But what we want to see as we work through a lot of these groups, they de-churched earlier. Continuing on, when we get to their orthodoxy score, 57%, not good. Contrast that with the mainstream evangelicals that are doing so well. Their orthodoxy score is higher than those who still go to church. This orthodoxy score is not good. When you go back to the orthodoxy score, you can see that 69% would say that Jesus is the Son of God, which is not terrible, it's not great, but their understanding of the Bible is abysmal. So, going forward, why they left, they tell us they left because they moved to a new community. I mean, I hope this is over-communication at this point. Had other priorities for my time and money, didn't fit within, disagreed with the politics of the congregation. This politics conversation, though, with the mainline is going to be largely anything that seems right. So it's not, as much political syncretism as it is things that seem too far right. I began to doubt God's existence. Sorry, I'm going to need to pull that back up. Attending was inconvenient. Divorce, remarriage, and other family change. I didn't experience much love from the congregation. So what do they need? They need word and deed together. They need us to avoid racism, misogyny, and partisan politics. Sound doctrine and spiritual formation, higher regard for the Bible. Now, on the politics side, that doesn't mean that we don't hold our views and that we're trying to adjust to whoever it is, adjust our doctrine and practice to whoever it is that is around us. We just have to be cognizant that we draw our values and the things that we do and engage this world as salt and light, that we're doing it because that it's fueled by the gospel, that it's built on the foundation of the Bible. So that's an important caveat. What I want to do is address some myths. We have some myths that I want to break apart from our study. First is that people leave because of negative experiences within the church. So we call that a myth because while that happens, that's not the lion's share of dechurching, and we have to understand that. Number two, the second myth is young people leave because of secular university. There's this idea that higher secular education is taking our children away, and we have emphatically proven from our research that that is not the case. Ryan Burge, our social scientist, has done a lot of work on this since. In our study, evangelicals who had a master's degree, of that group, of evangelicals who had a master's degree, only 3% had dechurched. When you look at students going to college, if they are involved in a local church and a college ministry, they are 3 times likely to stay in church. And so I say this, it falls apart if it's only a church or only a college ministry. And I feel weird saying only a church, so let me flesh that out. In the parachurch, in the college ministry side, you have this incredibly important life transition, and they give intense discipleship to help students make that transition. But if that's all they know, they're going to leave and look for that intense discipleship community in a local church, and they're not going to find it. And so they don't go to church. So on the other side, if you have a student who's able to worship in a local church, which is great, but doesn't have the discipleship that they need, that's not going to go as well either. Now, when I say college ministry, it could be something outside the church, like Campus Crusade, RUF, Pioneers, Young Life, or it could be something that the church does internally if the church has those kinds of resources. Myth number three, people leave the church because they left the faith. We have shown that millions of de-church people are, as best we can tell, still Christians. Again, this is not a monolithic group. Number four, people are leaving primarily on the secular left. We think of, in our larger society, it is the progressives, the liberals, the Democrats who are leaving church. That's not an argument that holds any weight. We would say that the earlier part of dechurching in the 90s and early 2000s was more on the secular left, but now the secular right is dechurching at twice the pace of the secular left. And you might say, well, that's because the secular left has already dechurched. And you would be right on that point, except that the secular right has caught up in total number to the secular left in terms of who has left the church. This changes a lot of things in our political landscape. This is the most political thing that I'll say. I'm making an observation. I'm not trying to make a political statement. But you can see this shift in how it affects politics, because it's unimaginable that the Republican Party of the 90s and early 2000s that was reeling over Bill Clinton's moral indiscretions would then go and nominate Donald Trump. Now, I'm not trying to make a... I'm just saying, like, you can see the effects of the right-wing dechurching. Myth number five, people are not willing to come back. They are. About 8 million evangelicals and about a similar number of mainline dechurched people are saying that they would be willing to come back today. Number six, America's peak religiosity was around the time of our founding. So, right now we're at about 49% of Americans who worship regularly. Do you know what that percentage was in 1776? 17%. Like, we're not looking to go back there. You know, if you compare, you know, we would, and it's not just us, we would make the argument. I'm pro United States of America. I am so thankful for the Constitution. I'm very thankful for the Constitution, but it's hard not to realize that the Constitution was the watershed document into secularism in the West. Because when you compare the Constitution of the United States to the constitutions of the colonies, there is an active effort to be less Christian. Look at the Constitution of Connecticut. It uses Jesus in there. Or if you think about the words that Thomas Jefferson wrote, we hold these truths to be self-evident. Do you know those weren't his original words? He originally wrote, we hold these truths to be sacred and undeniable. And Ben Franklin talked him out of that, both for brevity reasons and because it was too Christian. I'm going to add a last myth that I don't have a slide here for. The myth would go something like, de-churching is happening primarily among the upwardly mobile. That is a myth. De-churching is hitting the lower income, lower education people harder than anybody. Because think about it. If it's life transition that is causing people to fall out of church, you know, rhythms, who does that hit the hardest? If you lose your job, if you become a single parent, if you have to move, if you don't have the financial and social safety net to make that transition, you're the one who's going to be working longer hours and more unusual hours. So it's hitting the lower educated, lower income bracket the hardest. All right, here as we finish, going to the next slide, I want to talk about some top challenges for church planting and church growth. One, we need to embrace both confessional and missional. So many of our churches are going to, so when I say confessional, I mean what we confess to believe. Could be the Nicene Creed, Westminster Confession of Faith, could be the 1689 Confession of Faith if you're in the Reformed Baptist tradition. That's what we confess to believe. And then on the other side, you have churches what they're talking is less about what they confess to believe and more about how to be missional in what they do. What we would argue is what we confess to believe is inherently missional. The mission is based on what we confess to believe. And so we need to be careful that we're not on one end, which was our context, and I'll own this, that we're not a church that's theologically robust, but we haven't baptized someone, whether it's dunking or sprinkling, that isn't biologically related to us in 10 years. So we may have a robust theological understanding of things, but there's something that's not translating to the missional, to the missions outpost that we as a church are designed to be. And then on the other side, you might have a church that is very missional, and there's lots of people in there, but the ceiling of discipleship and spiritual development and formation is low. You're allowed to be anonymous in a way that I don't think the New Testament understands anonymity in the church. Church has been reduced to, and I don't doubt a lot of the heart in this, so I think they're wrong, but I think the heart is largely good because I've talked with a lot of these people. But entertainment is what drives getting people into the building. And what you win them with is what you win them to, and which reduces our worship functionally to Coldplay in a TED Talk. And we need more of the robust discipleship that comes from the confessional side. So the mission is built on the confession, and we need to understand that. There's more about that again in the book. I've got to go fast now. Two. We need to return to the hard work of evangelism discipleship. If you were a part of a church plant in the late 90s or early 2000s, you were probably doing something brand new in your city. So it could be contemporary music, it could be expository preaching, it could be relevant messages, whatever it is, it was probably new. And you probably benefited from Christian transfer growth. So people came over because they liked this new thing, they were already discipled, they knew how to give, and your church was self-sufficient within 2 years. That's not a realistic expectation anymore because ain't nobody doing something new. And if you are, we may need to have a conversation about that. And we're going to come back to this a little bit. Number three. More churches are closing now. So this is a Lifeway study that is fascinating to me because it shows the rapid shift of what we're looking at. 2014, 300 more churches opened than closed. So we're still in the black as churches. 2019, 5 years later, 1,500 more churches closed than opened. And that is before COVID. I haven't seen the most recent version of this LifeWay study. Number four, we believe that there is going to be a hollowing out of middle-sized churches in cities around the United States. And this is, I've given this talk to church planters, and they have affirmed this significantly. If you're below 100, you're very flexible. Probably you're more homogenous as a church, which has its challenges, but you're flexible. You get over, say, 400, and you have the resources to do what you need to do. But you get into the 150 to 300 or 100 to 350 space, and it is incredibly difficult to finance what it is that we're doing. You need a place to house all those people. You want a trained gospel, you know, minister of the gospel who's probably married, probably has kids, might send those kids to private school, wants to live somewhere around the church. And so the scales of economy just aren't there. It's becoming harder and harder and harder for these medium-sized churches to exist. And the sad thing is, I could give a whole nother talk on why we need these sized churches. The benefits, the kingdom benefit of the churches between 100 and 400 are significant, and they offer things that smaller and larger churches are simply not going to offer. So going to number five, because of all these things, we as the church, the ones who have more resources, are going to have to fund our church plants for longer periods of time. We're going to have to fund them for longer periods of time so that they can go back to the hard work of evangelism and discipleship. We don't want them following all these money-raising trails and pursuing Christian transfer growth just so they can make it. We want them reaching new people because that's what church plants do the best. Number six, we don't know if public schools or other public spaces are going to remain hospitable to churches. Is there a number seven? I think I'm going to add a number seven if there's not. There's seminaries. This is interesting. Seminaries are not only largely reporting fewer people, but even seminaries like RTS that are really doing well right now would say that the number of people in their system who want to be a senior pastor, much less church planter, is drastically decreasing. This is a discipleship issue. And then I think number eight is the one that better investment in 13 to 18 age range. I'm going to have to finish this fast. I might go a few minutes over. There are three, you are most likely to leave the church during this age range. So it could be high school, which is 13 to 18, college for most people, or establishing the young professional careers. So I'm going to speak to high school because this is, we have our own children. College and young professional is going to depend on context some, but we as a church need to come alongside the families to disciple our people, our children better. Now, I'm not talking about outsourcing what we're doing from the families, but coming alongside families for discipleship. I heard an atheist sociologist articulate that evolution has wired our kids to leave our homes, and because of that, they're less inclined to listen to what their parents have to say between the ages of about 13 to 25. So his argument is that we need other people saying the same things to our kids. And I would say, I actually think he's onto something. I think what I would modify is God's design is that our children would leave the house, and sin has marred that process. But when our youth volunteers say the same thing to my teenagers that I say, I'm, oh, dad, they're wise and brilliant. And so we're coming up with a comprehensive plan from birth to graduation of what we're doing as a church to come alongside parents. When are we going to talk about systematic theology, biblical theology, how to read the Bible, how to pray, how to share your faith? When do we address gender and identity issues so that parents can know this is how we're coming alongside? The last one I want to add is we need to be able to identify when people at highest risk of dechurching in our midst. So if they become a single parent, if they move. So in our context in Orlando, we're on the receiving end of moving. So we're talking with other churches about what does it look like to mobilize the people the new Christians in our city interact with first naturally. So school teachers, school administrators, realtors, how do we help them to see the missional value they have when we know that the lion's share of people who are moving might not ever attend a church again? So I said that I was going to do this in the way that I do ministry when I among dechurched. I have four questions that can help me identify who we are looking at. So, do you go to church? They'll say the answer is no. Did you used to? Yes. Now I know they're dechurched. Why did you stop going to church? Then I'm going to know, are they casually or casualty? And then I'll ask them something like, well, who is Jesus to you? Or what role does faith play in your life? And I know exactly who I'm looking at. And if it's a mainstream dechurch evangelical, I'm just asking them to church. And we used to think of an invitation to church as a relational killer in some ways. And maybe it is with certain people. If you do that to a dechurch ex-evangelical, that might be a relational killer. But with this group, I'm batting 1,000, and they continually say, oh, I'm so thankful for Jim. I'm so thankful, Jim. And I'm like, all I did was invite you to church. Like I didn't do anything, but they felt it and they desired it. So the opportunities here, there are 8 million dechurch evangelicals and a similar number of mainline dechurch people that are willing to come back today. Number two, if you want to read our book, we dive into a lot more of these things. Number three, we have a free assessment online at dechurching.com. It's sort of an audit that I'll flesh out on the next slide. It talks about both the front door and the back door. So front door is what everybody gets excited about, new people coming in. And that's a thing, having a digital game plan, arrivals, departures, so and such. But the back door is what we really need to be understanding, because I would argue this is what's caused a lot of the dechurching. So the back door, assimilation, I feel like it is a bare minimum responsibility that every group of leaders in any church knows how to pray for its people regularly. Not just pray, but pray substantively. Get your membership list out. I would argue that if we cannot pray substantively as leadership for every person on that roster, then we're failing. So we talk about counseling, LMHC, abuse prevention, students, and such. But where I want to finish this is just again saying that we believe that it is a privilege to minister in this era. We believe that the church is going to be fine. We believe that there's actually a purification that's going on right now, and that there's nobody like they were in the 20th century who's going to church because they want to run for office and have a successful business. You know, now people are largely going to church because of Jesus, and that's a good thing. We also understand that the global church is doing just fine. There are more Christians alive today in the global East and the global South than all the Christians who have ever lived for the first 1900 years combined. And we know that Jesus is going to complete what he started, that his church is going to be fine. So because of those things, we're not worried. There's not fear. There is hope and confidence and really a sense of privilege that we get to minister in this season. So thank you for having me. I hope this is helpful, and we'll do some panel talk.